Welcome to the Wiper and New Life Communion Service. Let's start with a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for this opportunity to meet together around your table and around your word. We pray that you'll bless this fellowship and communion with you. In Jesus' name, amen. So let's start with a reading from John 13. It said in verse 1, "Now before the feast of Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own, who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And supper being ended, the devil having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, arose from supper, laid aside his garments, took a towel and girded himself. After that he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. Then he came to Simon Peter. And Peter said to him, 'Lord, are you washing my feet?' Jesus answered and said to him, 'What I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this.' Jesus said to him, 'You shall never wash my feet.' Jesus answered him, 'If I do not wash you, you have no part with me.' Simon Peter said to him, 'Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head.' Jesus said to him, 'He who is washed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean, and you are clean, but not all of you. We knew who would betray him. Therefore, he said, "You are not all clean." So when he had washed their feet, taken his garments and sat down again, he said to them, 'Do you know what I've done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, "Well, for so I am." If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. I do not speak concerning all of you. I know whom I have chosen. But that the scripture may be fulfilled, he who eats bread with me has lifted up his heel against me. Now I tell you, before it comes to pass, that when it does come to pass, you may believe that I am he. Most assuredly I say to you, he who receives whomever I send receives me, and he who receives me receives him who sent me. When Jesus had said these things, he was troubled in spirit and testified and said, Most assuredly I say to you, one of you will betray me. Then the disciples looked at one another, perplexed about whom he spoke. Now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. Simon Peter therefore motioned to him to ask who it was of whom he spoke. Then leaning back on Jesus' breast, he said to him, Lord, who is it? Jesus answered, It is to whom I shall give a piece of bread when I have dipped it. And having dipped the bread, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, son of Simon. Now after the piece of bread, Satan entered him, and Jesus said to him, What you do, do quickly. But no one at the table knew for what reason he said this to him. So we see here a record of the Passover service. And particular note is the fact that John says here was leaning on the bosom of Jesus, and he had to lean back to talk to Jesus. So this is the traditional picture we have of the Passover service by Leonardo da Vinci. But of course, we probably all realize that this doesn't really reflect the reality of the situation. In Jesus's time, Jewish tradition demanded that the people partaking of the Passover had to recline. And moreover, they had to recline in a special way. They had to recline on their left elbow and eat with their right hand. And the idea that came about because they were copying Greek and Roman tradition, which were the freemen of their day. And those people used what's called a triclinium. And it was a three-sided table with couches, low couches alongside a low table. This is probably what that would have looked like. And when Jesus asked Peter and John to go and prepare or find the large upper room that was furnished, that word furnished actually alludes to this type of arrangement, a special room set aside for these type of feasts. What's more, there was also a regiment around how the seating could be arranged. And we know that in the past, Jesus had taken the disciples to task because of they were trying to become the greatest of the disciples, because they had a misguided sense that Jesus was there to promote an earthly kingdom rather than a spiritual one. And so they were wanting to sit in those positions of power. In the Passover service, the way that you demonstrated your honor or your position of influence was how you sat in relation to the host. So the host would sit in the middle of the left-hand side bench. On his right would be a close friend, and on his left would be the guest of honor. Then from that guest of honor, along the middle bench and along the right-hand bench, it would be a descending order of honor, so that the lowest would sit at the lowest part of the table. And this was, if not a servant, it would be the person that was expected to serve for the duration of the feast. So when Jesus did his foot washing, it said that they were reclining. And so Jesus got up and was able to wash the feet of the disciples quite easily, because their feet were to the side of the table. And then after he had done the foot washing, Jesus said that the person he trusted had lifted up his heel against him. And he was quoting here from Psalm 41, verse 9. Yea, mine own familiar friend in whom I trusted, which did eat of my bread, hath lifted up his heel against me. Now that word familiar friend means a man of peace, a close friend with whom you have no quarrel. Whereas a lifted heel means not just a nudge, it means a swinging kick. You know, what we would call a drop kick. So Jesus knew who would betray him, and yet he deliberately bent his head down in front of Judas and washed his feet. Even though, you know, the verse here talks about a swinging kick. Now it says that Jesus then gave the sop to Judas, and Judas departs. Now again, the idea of giving a sop was the way a host would honour the guest of honour, giving them the first taste of the Passover supper. So no one would have suspected Judas, because Jesus was honouring him at this time. Even though John had his suspicions that he was a thief, it said in John 13 that no one knew who he was talking about. And in fact, when Judas left, not even then did it arouse suspicion. So let's consider the possible or probable seating arrangement of John 13. We have here Jesus sitting in the middle on the left-hand side. We have on his right, John, the beloved disciple, who was reclining on the breast of Jesus and had to even lean back to talk to him, because remember, he's leaning on his left side. And we have Judas on his left in the guest of honor's position, because Jesus had given him the sop. And then we have the order of prominence right round until we get to the lowest position on the right-hand table, which was probably taken by Peter. Remember, Peter and John had prepared the room. They had most likely taken the two positions of favor that were open to them, the friend's seat and the lowest seat. They would have all been aware that Jesus required them, that those that wanted to be greatest had to take the lowest seat. And so it's no wonder that Peter took that seat in an attempt to show that he wanted to be the greatest. And in so doing, you know, almost sabotaged himself and his, because again, Jesus said to take the lowest seat, not so that you could be the greatest, but so that you could serve others. So it's little wonder that there was an argument, even at the Passover feast itself, and this is recorded in Luke 22, about who should be the greatest, because the disciples all knew what Peter and John had done to arrange the situation to their advantage. And of course, Jesus would have chosen who sat next to him in that position of honor. And that is likely to have been Judas, because he received that sop. Another reason why Peter probably was sitting remote from Jesus was because he had to beckon to John, you know, across the tables effectively, and get John to ask the question. And he would have been able to do so because he was face to face with John. Now remember the context in which Jesus had effectively promoted Judas to that position of honor. In Psalms it says he was a close friend. And I don't believe that Jesus was play acting here. I believe Judas was his close friend. I believe that he loved Judas. He certainly didn't want to see him condemned. And he knew the prophecies relating to the one who would betray him. So he washed Judas's feet. He gave Judas every opportunity to be clean. And yet Jesus refused it. Or Judas refused that that offer. And it said that he wasn't clean, despite what the Son of God had done. The Son of God who said that all things have been given into his hands by God. Yet he couldn't do that. So Jesus suffered not only at the crucifixion, but he suffered the rejection and betrayal of a close friend during the Passover service. No wonder he was troubled. So if Jesus, you know, was doing what he could to redeem someone, it still takes a personal decision of that person to be clean, to be redeemed. And we should remember that as we act as well. We show love because we love, not because we have to love. And so the foot washing wasn't just a symbol of humility. It was a symbol of that act of love and the desire to reach out and redeem, even though on display here was going to be some of the worst impulses of humanity, a deadly betrayal. And even though Jesus knew the scripture, he hoped against hope that Judas would repent. In light of that, let's take communion. Father in heaven, in Jesus' name, we thank you for the example that Jesus gave us, not only of humility, but love, and of reaching out even to those that others would write off as unlovable or irredeemable. Lord, we thank you in Jesus' name for the bread, your body, which is broken for us. Father, in the same manner we take the cup, knowing that it is his blood shed for us. Lord, we pray that as his disciples we may follow the example that our teacher and Lord gave us. Father, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you and give you peace. Amen.